The purpose is to tighten laxity of the anterior face. This is the area highlighted by the white oval. This is done from the side using the series of subsmash spaces that overlie the anterior masseter. The spaces are separated from each other by ligamentous boundaries, and therefore it's inherently safe to dissect within the spaces as the buccal trunks of the facial nerve travel within these boundaries. The skin flap dissection, as indicated by the crosshatch area, is limited. It extends only to the spaces. Then the dissection goes deeper to enter the spaces and continues in the spaces only to their anterior extent, which is at the edge of the masseter. There is no dissection into the anterior face at all. The anterior limit of the skin undermining is indicated by the oblique line in front of the blue crosshatching. It's about 45 millimeters forward of the upper tragus and 30 millimeters forward of the lower tragus, and it extends over the angle of the mandible for only about one finger breadth, then up behind the ear. The upper boundary of the lower premasseter space is indicated by a line extending from the oral commissure to the lower edge of the tragus. The lower edge of the zygoma is palpated, the inferior edge of the body marked, and the marking is continued along the lower border of the arch to the upper tragus. The angle of the mandible is located, and a marking 15 millimeters above it indicates the inferior limit of the smash dissection. The planned entrance to the space is now marked 30 millimeters forward of the ear and between the two lines. Then the line of entry to the upper spaces is marked by continuing a line that crosses the zygoma at the junction of the arch and the body. In preparation, the smash is elevated by traction, while the surgeon looks for muscle fibers of the smash. The space itself is not visible because it is deep to the smash. The platysma is a guide to the location of the space because it is present in the roof of the space but not present posterior to the space. Now, the blade carefully opens through the roof into the space. Correct entrance to the space is confirmed by the appearance of areolar tissue within. The scissor tip is now used to commence opening the space bluntly. The retractor then holds the roof under traction and the blunt dissector sweeps the areolar tissue down off the ceiling. The fingertip is the best blunt dissector and the space is gently but not forcibly open to its boundaries. Now, inside the space, you can see the lower buccal trunk running obliquely on the masseter under the masseter fascia floor. The platysma is in the roof, or more particularly in the ceiling. Here is the lower 15 millimeters of the posterior boundary that wasn't opened in order to protect the mandibular branch. And here is the firm upper boundary between the lower space and the middle space. First, the smash is incised, extending over the posterior body of the zygoma and into the lower part of the orbicularis. The entrance to the space isn't visible, but it's revealed by the following maneuver. With the tip of the scissor placed 2 to 4 millimeters above the boundary of the lower space, and with the blade directed transversely towards the upper lip, the entrance to the space is revealed by gently spreading of the scissor. Once this opens, the retractor is then inserted to elevate the roof. The upper buccal trunk is clearly seen in the upper boundary, and the lower buccal trunk is in the lower boundary. Gentle spreading and then wiping of the buccal fat off the ceiling is performed to define the anterior extent of the space. The posterior part of the lower membrane can be safely released provided it is released high off the smash, as the lower buccal trunk is low at this level. The lower buccal trunk is identified and cleared only as needed for identification, and obviously less than is being done in this demonstration. The scissor tip is placed 5 millimeters above the upper boundary of the middle space and directed transversely towards the alar base. The space is initially opened by spreading the scissor tips. The dissection is continued by placing the retractor and continuing the opening. The zygomatic ligament directly on the inferior aspect of zygomaticus major is defined, and then when secure, it's released. the prezygomatic space is entered by placing the lower blade of the scissor directly on the bone of the body of the zygoma, just above zygomaticus major, and with the scissor tip pointing toward the lateral canthus. Slowly and steadily lifting the soft tissue opens the potential space using the retractor for countertraction. Here you can see into the middle premasseter space. It's because the walls have been removed that you can see the contents behind the walls much more than you would in a usual dissection. Note how the upper buccal trunk ascends in the wall to approach the underside of the smass near the anterior entrance. The upper buccal trunk of the facial nerve is seen, as well as its interconnections above and to the lower trunk. The masseteric prolongation of the buccal fat pad enters the space itself by bulging of its covering membrane at the entrance. The parotid duct travels under the membrane on the floor, just beneath the upper boundary. Excess buccal fat can be removed, but this must be done with caution, as the interconnecting buccal nerve branches overlie the membrane on the roof of the buccal space. The first suture goes through the middle space into the mobile smass immediately anterior to the space. This is over the roof of the buccal fat. The bite into the smass must be carefully placed to avoid the communicating branch between the upper and lower buccal trunks. Then it is secured to the fixed mass overlying the parotid, the so-called platysma auricular fascia. The figure of eight suture is non-absorbable and braided as it is functioning to replicate a masseteric ligament. The second suture is into the smass ceiling of the lower space, just forward of the anterosuperior corner of the space, in the vicinity of the lower key masseteric ligament. This suture is to correct the labiomandibular fold and jawline. The third suture goes into the upper space between the zygomatic and upper buccal trunks and is placed with a similar technique. The upper suture corrects the middle part of the nasolabial fold. A fourth suture is used to correct the upper nasolabial fold if required. It goes through the prezygomatic space and secures the underside of the orbicularis in the roof. As with the other sutures, it is secured to the posterior fixed mass or to the periosteum of the zygoma. The effect of each suture can now be observed. The lower space suture for the labiomandibular fold and jawline, the middle space suture for the nasolabial fold next to the oral commissure, the upper space suture for the nasolabial fold above that, and the prezygomatic space suture for the top of the nasolabial fold. To contour the neck, a superficial subcutaneous dissection is first performed to just below the angle of the mandible. Here the platysma is engaged, and then it is securely fixed posteriorly to the platysma auricular ligament. A second figure of eight suture is required for optimal platysma contouring. A continuous suture is used to advance the smass posteriorly. The suture commences low inside the space, picking up the underside of the roof of the space, and it tightens the smass initially inferior to the lowest key masseteric suture, which further tightens along the jawline with safety. The smass closure suture then advances posterior to the spaces up to the top of the smass incision. An absorbable suture is used that works well on a J needle. At the top, the suture imbricates the orbicularis oculi without preliminary undermining. In returning the suture back down in front of the ear, the lower part of the composite flap is brought right against the ear. As a result, there is minimal residual skin undermining. The skin flap has not yet been closed on the operator right side. Forceful finger pressure mimics the effect of gravity and shows that the right side has limited excursion compared to the left side, which has not been operated.